That's right, isn't it? Yeah.
I hate talking into things that are scouted if you don't. And you're misquoted. There's not much you can do about it. Unless they're witnesses.
Well, there are witnesses. Maybe we'll just run a little bit.
Right. Turn it over.
Look like you could take on a couple of tires.
I'm his
publisher. Put on a couple of tires, you say?
Very good
check. Are you using his own
name? You get the credits and chewing
you.
You
are in the check, anything?
Hmm?
Anything?
Well, I'm, you know, in my usual condition, which is climbing the wall at this point, you know, this close to an open wall. Ah, this is a piece of gum. Well, it doesn't take out my bridge. Got a bridge just pasted in my Key West doctor. It's a Key West dentist before. Took a look at me and thought, just good. Do it last long enough, you just paste it.
Just paste it. Last for a couple of weeks and that's all you need.
He does. Frantically on the play, yes, I am.
In terms of rewriting?
Have been ever since I got involved in it.
When did you first get involved in this play?
Well, rather suddenly, and you see, it was a play I wrote in the late 60s at a time when. Well, I didn't pay too much. I think I moved it very quickly. I was writing very quickly at the time I wrote this. And I think I wrote it in a matter of days.
Where did you write it?
Where did I write it from?
Where?
I wrote it in the, I recall writing it in the Mayfair Towers, a hideous high-rise adjoining the Dakota. You know, on West 72nd Street, it started falling down as it was about. And 1 week after it opened, they had every filthy word in, in the outside of Webster's, you know, scratch in the elevator. An appalling
that place. Probably is liable.
An appalling place, no, appalling place. And I was there for God knows how, I think so there for around 3 years. I suddenly got too much of it and I called Manhattan Stories and told them to come over and clear it up. And then I moved from hotel to hotel. Do you remember that period of my life, Bob? Joe Healy tells me that I was in one of those hotels, the Owlery, I believe. That she was visiting me with Rose one evening, and that I suddenly snatched up the phone and called the cops and said there was a hooker in my room pushing dope and condescending to my sister. And she said she had a hard time just waiting to come to arrest.
Arrest her.
Imagine resting Joe Healy as well.
Sure.
I know that this play was published in the very day of
it. I'm going to take your coat and let's go to the room.
I
was published with the verses?
Under the title of Confession.
No, he just went out to give me some eyebrows.
I was just by this change of venue here.
Yeah.
Would you mind sitting in that yellow chair? I think you'd be more comfortable with the light.
Hey Hank, did you get me some eye drops?
In any case, you wrote the play when you were in the Mayfair, you said?
Yes, yes. Not while I was running for Mayfair, but it felt like a bat.
did you write several things at that time? Was that time you also
to this play, this play sort of came in a period when I was working on Kingdom of Earth and the slapstick tragedy and in the bar of the Tokyo Hotel. It was sandwiched between and the Nightly Quest, the novella, a book of stories. It's all in that period.
Was the Tokyo Hotel the last of that series?
I really can't tell you the sequence.
Do you remember what triggered off this play? What the initial germ of it? What brought it about? What did you?
I'm not sure. It was dimly based upon a recollection of a bar that I had known in my youth on the West Coast.
It was a picture of one lady in a sailor hat or something like that.
No, she was not. The lady was not the character. The character was an imaginary character.
Yeah. And since then, you have worked on it again.
Yes. I'm trying to think when it surfaced. Well, actually, it surfaced first in print. When Mr. McGregor here brought out, what is that there? Oh, no.
Bungie?
No. The voice.
Book is called Dragon.
Yeah, it was in a book called Dragon Country. It was a service while I was in the bin, or just after I got out, I forget which.
Service
practice? It did appear after I got out, didn't it? Yes. Yeah, a month or so after I got out.
Written before and surfaced when you
got out? Surfaced after in this collection, which had a most curious cover on it. A magnified cell, a malignant cell, wasn't it? A microscopic view of a malignant cell. I'm rather distressed with that cover.
Since the publication, you have revised it in some ways.
Yes, it surfaced last summer as a play in production up at a place called Bar Harbor, Maine, in their workshop. It was done for 3 days in their workshop.
Did you see?
Not one of their regular offerings. No, I was embroiled at that time in the tryout of a play in Chicago. And it was such a hassle there that I wasn't free to get up to see it. So I never saw it. But he, the theater sent me their notices, which were the best I'd received in about 10 years. And so the producer was encouraged to get a Broadway production for it. When I came back from Europe, I believe it was, early last fall, the play had come into the hands of Echo Productions, which consisted of Bob Curry and Bill Orton and Mario Di Maria. They're all connected with hands. You can open it. You can get it open. And they wanted to produce it. Well, it was not a full evening. I went to work on it, to expand it, but not changing the essential part of it. But providing it with a, you know, connecting tissue, as it were.
Professional was the title of that.
At that time, yeah.
Is it less confessional now that it's not called confessional? Or less of a religious play?
It never was religious. I believe it said something terribly corny to Mr. Leonard Harris yesterday. He was interviewing me in the rehearsal hall. He asked me if it was religious. I said, no, that's a reverence for the human heart is interpreted as religion. That's a very common phrase, a reverence for the human heart. I said, please, for God's sake, take that out. And I doubt you will, my journalists. This is another thing they usually head the piece with.
Reverence or irreverence?
But they told you tell them to cut out, they would make the top of the piece.
Reverence or irreverence?
Reverence. I do have that. I'm missing the cue of that. I don't think I've got much reverence for the art of the people that have become. Written by some people in public life, but for the human heart in general, reverence is too strong a term. I have, you know, an interest, a sympathy, a respect for. And unfortunately, I chose the word reverence because he chose the word religious.
In some interview, I guess Melvyn Hayes is saying that some comparison between the bar and a church, and so I thought perhaps you really had an early version to play something more.
I think there'll be enough of that effect remaining in the play without it being laid on so quite so heavily in the stage.
Before it was done in Maine, had you thought of it as unproducible or something that would not be produced, let's say?
No, I read it. I read the volume. And I thought it was a volume of plays that I had written in the 60s, except for two exceptions. One being the play called I Rise and Play in Ground of the Phoenix, which is about deep lines that I had written in 39, 40, and 41. The other was a perfect analysis given by a parrot, which I wrote in Houston, Texas, just after the Glass Menagerie, a little bit of a comedy. The only plays in the book that impressed me very much where the Gnädiges Fräulein, confessional, and I can't imagine tomorrow. Professional from the Glee. Short plays and lines that I thought were good for value.
But actually, until they started Maine, you yourself didn't try to put together a Broadway production.
Mm.
I'm just curious how
no.
indirectly they came about.
No, I've never tried to put together a Broadway production. That's what agents, you know, function.
You've changed agents.
Yes.
Is that something very crucial in your
life? I think so. Not to expand upon that matter. Excuse me, I want to get myself a little wine. Was there some wine? Would you have some?
Yes, I'd love some.
How about you, Michael? Oh, I bet you are. I bet it's laced with something.
Is this your voice?
I wish it were.
Not that shit.
It's not a good shit. You want to go off in the game?
Yes.
I'm
sorry.
I get to watch these people.
Okay.
Salut.
Amore bizarres. In the opposite aura.
Mine is very civil.
It is a civilized drink, isn't it?
Besides, it's good.
It soothes the savage in the human breast. Better than music.
Remember, you said it.
They tell me it's not especially good for the liver, but I don't know any liquor that is.
It's probably better for the liver than some other liver.
Yeah.
It'd be great, I think.
Mm. It's great for the nerves, yeah. I like to see a journalist take some wine. That Miss Carol will be interviewed more.
Oh, she will.
She will be. She will.
Yeah. I think there's been too much interviewing of me because I'm repeating myself most of the time. I don't have much fresh material to offer. Oh, hello, Mario. This is one of my producers, Mr. De Maria. Mr. Gussow.
Excuse me. How are you? I was saying though that you did feel that the reason why you were interviewed, at least during this period now,
mm-hmm.
That there's several reasons why specifically you were more in public view, let's say, than you were at other times. And one was to set the record straight, I suppose. Past interviews that you were upset about?
Yes, I was very upset by certain interviews, notably one that appeared in December 1969 issue of Esquire, which was called A Dream of Tennessee Williams. An interview written with me by a man whom I refused to see. And he invented the whole interview. And it was the most shocking thing imagined. But it was surpassed in defamation by one that appeared in the Atlantic Monthly at the time when I had just gotten out of the hospital. When I was, in mortal dread of dropping dead at any moment. And when I was trying to get my shit together, as they say. The man, I said I was not in any condition to be interviewed. The man said, "Oh, Mr. Williams, I'm only interested in your work, in a serious discussion of your work." So he came to Key West. He had come to Key West. He said, "I'm down here to recuperate from the illness, and I just want to talk to you about your work." I said, "That's all right. Please, anyone be interested in it?" Because it's been more or less an eclipse for 10 years. Well, at least since the one. And so I saw the man, and he was a good company and a good bridge player. The first time I saw him, at this time I was only taking allowed one martini a day. And I saw him at a mutual friend's apartment. And at that time, my Dr. William G. Von Stein, he's a reputable doctor, isn't he, Bob? The most reputable. Yeah, he's a doctor of my publisher. He had prescribed for me a not antidepressant because I was somewhat depressed, as you might imagine, not knowing when they popped me back in the bin. And he had prescribed for me something called Sinequan, which is an antidepressant. Well, I took it only once a day, and unfortunately I took it at the time I took the single martini. Well, on the occasion that I talked to this gentleman from the Atlantic Monthly, I dropped the Cinequan tablet and washed it down with the martini, which was the strongest tasting I've discovered, 100-proof vodka, you know. And I think the whole thing was set up by this invidious young writer in Key West, whose name I won't mention.
Whose name I know.
Yeah.
Whose person
I know. Yeah. Perhaps
share my opinion.
What?
He's a colleague of the Times.
Oh, this man did the interview, isn't it? Buckley, a charming man, isn't he? He didn't even know what street I lived on. He said I lived on Duval Street, which is the main drag. I happen to live on the outskirts of town. And that is the spare sample of his accuracy. Well, anyway, after dropping the Cinequan with the martini, he being assured that he was only interested in my work, I began to talk freely, very, very freely, you know, because there was a synergistic effect between the Cinequan tablet and the liquor in my head. I just knew. I didn't know what had happened. My head seemed to go up to the ceiling, and I could hear myself chattering like a bird, you know? Like a crazy bird, right on local weed, you know? I didn't know what I was saying. And this man had a concealed tape recorder. He claims that I knew he had. I swear. Well, I won't say to God, I hold my sister dearer than God. I swear by my sister's honor, I did not know he had concealed.
And it was not a serious discussion of your work.
He selected every bit of salacious material he could possibly select from very general discussion of early sex experience and concentrated upon that. The whole piece was concentrated upon things that made me appear to be an absolute degenerate, which I do not think I am.
Could you sue for something?
Of course I could have, but I've been well enough to go to New York and stand trial. I asked my lawyer to sue at once. I got rid of the lawyer because he didn't.
Do you find that happens a lot in that people?
Then I called Esquire magazine and said, "This, I don't think I can ever have a play done again in America and get their notices on top of this horrible expose type of sensational interviews. Will you please set up for me a serious type of interview? And he said, I'd be happy to do this for you. He just accepted a short play of mine of publication. And he said, I'd be happy to. Well, he sent Mr. Rex Reed to New Orleans to interview me. Well, I must say, the Rex Reed interview was wildly amusing. And people who know me well say it sounds just like me. I don't object to that.
Actually,
I think it was unfortunate, but I cannot object to it. Nor say that it was libelous, except that Mr. Rex Reed has me pinching the behind of a black waiter. And I have too much respect for the blacks to do such a thing. And anyway, even if I were drunk, I would behave like that in the crowd and restaurant. And I called him about that. And I said, how dare you say that I pinched the backside of this black waiter? He said, oh no, he was blonde and freckled. As if that were a totally different aspect from the thing.
Actually, in the earlier Esquire piece, that non-interview, posing as an interview.
Well, that was very, very libelous, which I reminded Mr. Harold somebody, Hayes, I reminded him of that, how libelous that had been. I thought that would offer me some protection. That would finally get a good write-up, you know. I'm still waiting for one.
that earlier piece, though, I do remember that it seemed at one point there was a somewhat serious discussion of the work. In fact, the writer made out a case for your...
Oh, they always throw
later,
in something.
Later plays being...
They always throw in something that they think will pacify you like that.
Didn't pacify you.
Certainly not.
I think he said, in fact, that in the Bar of the Tokyo Hotel was your best play.
Well, everybody knows it isn't, so you're quite safe in offering that opinion.
Do you think it isn't?
Don't think anybody regards In the Bar of a Tokyo Hotel as better than Cattle of a Hot Tin Room or a Streetcar Named Desire, do you?
I don't.
Nobody in their right mind. It's not much better than people made it out to be, yes, in its published version. Incidentally, Kingdom of Earth has been revived quite well on the West Coast. And people are surprised it was received so badly by the New York Press. I saw it out there. It was very, very good.
I was curious that your last couple of plays have been received very badly by the New York Press.
Curious, is it?
It is curious.
I think I was in a bad personal publicity I've gotten with my security.
Does that have an effect on you?
Say.
Do you have any notion what they might say about this one? What's your anticipation?
I don't intend to. Expose myself to it.
You mean you won't read that?
I'm going to see this play through opening night. There will be a car waiting for me at the door of the theater and take me to LaGuardia Airport. And where I'm headed from there, no one is going to know. No word. I've done my job. Paid my dues. Many truths.
You're not leaving the country.
Not immediately.
Soon,
I have my passport in order. Yeah.
Story.
contemporaries. And this play was one of the but he always takes things out. He used to have a footlocker that was filled with manuscripts. And he, when he wanted to, he didn't have an idea, he went in there.
Mm-hmm.
An old manuscript.
You mean something like this, yeah. Well,
it's a bigger
idea than that.
Yes, a much bigger one, yeah.
And the fact that he has rewritten Confessional is typical.
We're always changing titles and changing plays and everything.
Well, he's always working over material.
Writing is an important part of my life, yes.
May I interject?
What?
Michael was concerned. She was sure that you had heard you say that you wrote it in 39.
39?
Yeah, did you understand that?
Heavens, no.
She was sure she heard you say that. She was very concerned.
No.
'39 was a crucial year for you, wasn't it? Now that we're bringing it up, isn't it?
All years have been crucial years.
Wasn't that a particularly crucial year, though? I mean, if I remember right, that was when you went to New Orleans.
38, I went to New Orleans, and 39, I went to California. I was in California in 39, I believe.
Yeah. But a lot happened to you during those 2 years that you've written about writers, isn't it?
Yes, a great deal.
Were you writing in 38, 39, or?
Are you speaking my age or the year?
The year, 38, 39.
Was I writing then?
Were you writing then, or?
I started writing long before then. I started writing long before, I guess.
But just that I wonder whether in those particular years you were so busy living and experiencing it all that you weren't writing quite as much, and that you began writing after all this.
Writing has always been a daily imperative.
Many of the plays trace back to those couple of years, and you know, the roots of that.
Some of the short stories trace back to 38 and 39 in New Orleans and California. Yeah.
Some of those stories that became.
Yes, indeed.
From Streetcar for One would come out of.
Streetcar was written in New Orleans in 1947, a good deal of it, and then it really caught hold of me in Key West in the spring of 47. I was there with my grandfather. So yeah, I had one of those periods of great creative activity, and I finished it up in just a few weeks.
You really do think about a play over a long period of time before you write it?
Usually. I start it and abandon it as hopeless, and then just lay it aside for a few months, then pick it up again, abandon it as hopeless once more. And then some time passes, and I finish it, and then I think it's hopeless, and leave it around for a while, and I look at it, and it doesn't seem as bad as it did, and then I send it to my agent, and something either does or doesn't happen.
Was there ever a case in which you sat down, wrote a play, finished a play, didn't put it aside, come back to it again?
If you're thinking of some very short plays, yes, some I did immediately, and there was no reason to go back to.
The longer plays, though, would always
longer plays, yes. The only one that I can think of that I did not do, if it's a start, so it was a play never produced called Stairs to the Roof. Oh, it was produced at the Pasadena Playhouse, yes. But that's the only production that was given. I was working desperately against time then. It was the only time I worked with a schedule. I had it tacked onto the wall of the gallery, the what they call the slave quarters, the rooming house in New Orleans where I was living, and you know, and they had each scene, you know, written out a note for each scene, and I'd say Monday he discovered the stairs to rule, Tuesday he is caught at it, Wednesday he has fights with his wife, and so on, you know, and I followed that schedule, and I adhered just strictly to that play until I'd gotten all the way through it, and I sent it off, and nothing happened about it.
Well, that's about a,
except that finally got into the hands of Margot Jones, the late Margot Jones of Dallas, who turned it over to Pasadena to play out, who gave it a production. The head of the Pasadena Playhouse was named Brown, wasn't he? Yeah, and he produced it out there. I was very pleased with it, I remember. But I didn't get to see it. Hello. All right, yeah. Yes. Thank you. This was a call from the Kremlin.
Yes.
You think we can notify there was a bomb plant?
That was a play that you didn't go back to, or you haven't yet gone back to.
I finished it on schedule.
And that was it.
Because I didn't have a penny. I had to bum cigarettes. And I thought this would be my fortune. It was about my life and the shoe company. I've got a copy of it at last.
Rocket ship to outer space or something, was it?
It ended with the It ended with a couple being rocketed out into space to start a new world. Yes, and there are scenes in it which are as good as anything I've written, but as a whole, I don't think it comes off.
You have no words to go back to it again. Not many things.
Well, if I didn't have other things, I think it should be done sometime, just in the spirit in which it was written, you know? As a piece of juvenilia, you know, with all the freshness of youth in it, and convictions, and I think it should be done sometime. It should be done very well. All my work has to be done extremely well, or it's better not done at all.
What about the plays in Chicago? Outcry, I suppose, is it called
that? Yes.
Will that be done here?
There are two plays, actually. There is one called Two Character Play, which Mr. McGregor, New Directions, brought out private edition. It's priced out of most people's purchasing power or inflammation. You know, $40 a copy, I can't afford it myself.
More expensive than Broadway.
Yes. It's quite a charming play, I think. Then I began to work on it in 69, and I did version after version after version. The phone call in the bedroom concerns what we think is a fairly sentence. commitment from Mr. Bob Schofield to do it as soon as he's completed his next duty. If he does in London and the score is there, you bring it here.
Wasn't the two character play done in London?
The two character play, but now they're quite divergent.
So there are actually two completely different plays?
No. The middle section hasn't changed that much. But the first act and the third act are very, very different.
Two characters.
Very difficult to sustain.
It's called Outcry now.
Outcry. It really did lead. We had a fabulous actor down in Madden in Chicago. Eileen Hurley's also a fine actress, but they were not believable with brother and sister. And there were other difficulties I would go into, such as Dylan taking daily ads. Forcing me to have back-to-back interviews to collapse. To compensate for their refusal to take daily ads, which would not have offended me, except they were living so high on the hall of the penthouse apartments on the lakefront. And why couldn't I take out just this much of a daily ad? It's cheaper to put me through back-to-back interviews, which then killed me before we started the rehearsal.
Who would play Schofield's sister?
Well, that was under discussion, you see.
I think
Mrs. Schofield would discard that matter. Name has been mentioned, but...
Talking about the conditions, eh?
The fact is, he is, you know, really, said he would do it. Well, he told me that before, but now he says he's going to do it at a specific, within a specific period of time. So that makes it. Yes.
I can't think of any American plays.
Very reassuring.
He's ever done it before, that's not.
Man of all seasons. Man of all seasons.
American.
Oh, that was an American play. No, he appeared in America.
Oh, no, of course. I've seen it.
He's going to open in London, I suppose, to see how. I hope he'll come up with it. If he doesn't, I'd like to see the American production of a two-character play, which is a play for young people, for young actors.
The original play?
For young actors, yeah, young
people. When I stage both the same?
Hmm?
Stage both the same time or something?
Yeah. I'd just like to see them both. Did I not put drops in my eyes? They're still burning. I think I did, but this isn't my prescription. No, my prescription drops, they don't do so well. My eyes are extremely sensitive. One is almost totally blind. Hasn't been since my late 20s. The cataract. What else did I have?
What else have you done in the last 2 years since you...
Are you speaking of professional matters?
All matters. All matters. Since you fully recovered and...
Fully recovered, do you say? I was told just 5 days ago that my pulse rate was twice normal. And that I must rest at once. And I said, how do you think I'm going to rest? With a play opening on Easter Sunday, which incidentally I did not choose as an opening date. I think it's a very embarrassing date to open on. But they tell me that the rest of the week it's all occupied, and on the day we got to attract the critics to the Bowery on Easter Sunday evening. Well, as he does not detract from that.
Had you thought about opening it on your birthday?
But he used to love me. Somebody bound to make crack about the resurrection.
Well, did you say it's not a religious place?
Even,
so
they say the resurrection didn't come off. Something nice
it's
like that.
One of the very best short stories, I think.
What?
He's ever written in the
last. What is it? What is it about?
It was like Happy August.
Happy August the 10th, yes.
When did you write that?
Just before I went to Bangkok. Happy August 10th. Really? Well, it's one of the funniest, I think. It's a very funny story. Sad, too, I guess.
Do you feel at all that is a resurrection for you? I'm here with people several years ago, at least in terms of your plays.
Do I feel it's a resurrection? Do you mean professionally?
Professionally, absolutely. Did feel that in the sense that the critics were sort of waiting
this
for
this is not just my opinion.
Yeah.
I assure you it's a general opinion.
What, as long as you use the expression major works, what do you think of as your major works?
I don't
think. Yet you do think of some as not being major works.
It depends also upon what you mean by major.
What do you mean by major?
By major, I think of those that deal with a large subject in a large way, you know. Sometimes they can deal with a large subject in more economical way, more concentrated way, or a shorter way. Then there are works, of course, that I think are defective to the point of not being, even though they may have been very ambitiously undertaken, they have not been carried out successfully and working, and consequently they are certainly not works of much stature. In the Bible, the view tell was not out of a condition like that. What work, but there were parts of it that I still love, and in its printed version, I think it's obviously worthy of serious attention.
I would think certainly in terms of its theme that one should consider that.
Yeah.
to it. If your definition is large things, whichever it is. And the idea of an artist who can't create anymore is a pretty large issue. But it's
not just that.
So it's even larger. Could you say what this play's about, what the themes are in this concern?
Is there any reason why I should?
No.
I don't think.
Yeah. It would be a little particularly valuable for me too, since it's about so close to opening. And if you're interested, you can see.
What do you think you might do next? What's going around in your mind in terms of the play?
Well, I have several projects. I hope that I will get to see how I'm much more interested right now in resuming a normal and more less frenetic way of life than I've been experiencing the last few weeks. You know, not that it hasn't been exciting, but it's been very wet. And I couldn't continue it much longer.
As you're reading papers, you're going to lots of parties, it seems.
Yes, that's quite an active social event, which is good.
Do you enjoy them?
I love parties. If they're not used. You see, I'm so completely preoccupied with, whatever I'm doing at the time. I don't like to discuss other writings.
Did you write this play for Helena Carroll?
For what?
For Helena Carroll. Is it written for her?
No, of course, I hadn't heard of. No. I didn't have
it. Written it for anyone. Have you seen many plays since you've been having an active social life?
Let's see now. You mean since the rehearsal time? The rehearsals. I've been seeing movies.
What did you see?
I saw the last picture show.
How'd you feel about that?
It was strongly reminiscent to me of William Hayes. I liked it.
What else have you seen?
Movies, let's see. I find it been a bit tired in the evenings. Unless it's a party that it's more or less necessary to go to. I like to just sit here and see what's on TV, you know?
What do you watch on TV?
I especially like the newscasts, CBS.
Do you like the news?
Yeah. I don't like the news, but I like the newscasts.
The newscasts?
Yeah.
CBS
is
good.
Yeah. That's my favorite. Cronkite. I love Cronkite.
What do you like about that?
Well, I think he comes closer to telling the real truth about that. Interpreting it.
Easter eggs from our children.
Easter eggs?
Easter eggs, yes.
Mm.
I understand, I read a thing last week, they've all exploded. 78 million little chocolate Easter eggs, But, you know,
listen, darling, did you see Cronkite last night? You're exposing what is found in candies for children, the rodents and insect parts. Mm-hmm. You know, the percentage of rodent and insect parts in candies, and it's just appalling.
We don't really, thank God, our children aren't turned
off to it. Well, keep them off it, do you?
And I love it.
Yeah.
Just about it. I've been shoving their fat little faces full of things like dried apricots. And
yeah.
That's pretty terrible, you know.
Really?
Well, really, because they apparently take out all the natural ingredients and they put in the coloring.
Oh, God.
Like
a
maraschino cherry and dried apricots.
All these years, I thought dehydrated fruits were really more of
quite the opposite.
Tennessee, since Mel saw the play last night, you did see it last night, didn't you, Mel?
Oh, it was visible.
I think it, Paul, of course he knew that it was a dress rehearsal in the scene, but I think it might not be a bad idea if you would talk about what you feel the play is, because it might help establish a frame of reference for the people he was writing for. If you would, you know.
Darling, it's a lovely idea, but one is subject to certain attritions during the course of a week like this, you know? And I'm just not up to discussing what the play is about now. I think there's going to be a necessary shift of emphasis, yeah. I think last night I thought, my God, this seems to be a play about groping.
Groping.
they'll say it is, but it is not.
Goodbye,
darling.
Good
seeing
you.
Thank you.
I'm so pleased you brought your teddy bear home.
It was Michael, the little teddy bear.
Oh, it was you, love. Yeah. What is that curious silver ornament on the bottom?
It's brass. It's a horse brass. It's to ward off evil spirits.
I wear an Easter Sunday.
Bring good luck.
Goodbye.
Goodbye.
Bye.
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 This may bring back Laura Turnpike. The seven is getting all the publicity and news. Have you ever watched that?
It's very folksy on Channel 7.
The
newscasters banter with one another and tell jokes and spook each other.
I watch it sometimes. This is good.
Yeah, you've
every night
that.
When Walter Cronkite's on, on Channel 7.
Yes, you mean the regular Cronkite program. Oh, yes, they have the correspondent here and there and there, yeah.
Yeah, but on the other channel, Channel 7, it's completely not like Walter Cronkite, because they sit around and they tell some jokes.
Channel 7 CBS?
ABC. Yeah. Occasionally they drop some news, but more often it's about, their own.
They kid each other a lot about personal things.
Uh-huh.
And it's a very informal format. They have about four or five people that sit at separate desks.
Sort of like an improvisational
club.
They're copying
back and
format
forth.
A lot of TVs.
They are.
Yeah. Miami now.
It's a very good success.
Well.
Uh-huh.
When you said you watched the news, that was the first thing I thought about.
Well, I hadn't watched it. No, I always watched Cronkite, you know? And,
but you must be as depressed by the news as anybody is, I suppose, of course.
I'm very interested in it. Interpreted in various ways. I found it very depressing that Wallace was so popular in my legal residence, Florida.
He may also be popular in Wisconsin, too.
Is he also popular there? I'm very pleased that my brother got nearly 30% of the vote in Illinois in his race with the U.S. Senate.
He lost, but won.
He lost, but won more.
You ever thought about running?
There was this is a family on the Whitney side.
Did you watch Nixon's trip to China?
Yes. And Donald, Mrs. Nixon was jumping there. So was he going to think of it?
Where are they
going? I'd love to wink to Vice President Agnew if he worked in the airport. I didn't know that was going on.
Probably what you winked about, it came out later that she wasn't drinking any of the whiskey in China. She was just touching it to her mouth.
Oh,
that
was it.
Not eating the food either.
Really?
Yeah. No. No, I rather admire Mrs. Nixon. I mean, she's there's quite brave.
Brave. Kind of
good
about Mr.
Nixon's stuff. I never deal in prison now.
You never deal in
prison. Not if they can avoid it. Unfortunately, sometimes my names are put upon committees. I assure you I don't belong to the committees. Because I belong to nothing but the Dramatists Guild, and I tend to belong to the Dramatists Guild. It satisfies me.
How do you feel about other playwrights?
But I don't like people putting my names on committees, although I may agree completely, 100% or 1,000% of what they're talking about. Still, I do not join them, and I do not join them. And when people put my name down as if I belong without asking me permission, it's rather annoying. Like when I got caught up in that People's Coalition for Justice thing at St. John the Divine Cathedral, and this Norman Mailer atrocity occurs, you know, in the cathedral, for the embarrassment of this very fine man, Bishop Paul Moore. You know, I had to walk out. And I thought never again would this happen, but it has happened again.
You don't believe in taking political stands?
I think of my position in regard to, you know, politics, what things I'm for and what things I'm for against, if it's not clear in my work, then why should it be incorporated in a manifesto?
Except you are a political playwright.
Do you think so?
Do you think so?
Except implicitly, perhaps.
More so in any one play than others?
The most political thing I've ever think. No, I've never done anything politically. The one thing that contains the strongest social comment is probably the picture called Boom, in which the allegory is blatantly strong. But you ever seen Boom before? You don't
know. So the play twice.
It's both plays a little bit different. Some are similar.
Religious allegory wasn't a political allegory.
Mm-hmm.
It was a religious allegory, not a political allegory.
It was a political, more than religious. Boom.
How have you felt about the movies made in your plays? Have you been satisfied?
Rarely. Rarely. Unfortunately, Elizabeth Taylor is not an actress whom I can write for. But several of my best roles have been given her. She is limited. She likes humor. And I don't think she's likely to hit any great dramatic I've seen. And she's a very attractive woman. Yes.
you could play the part in your play. Yeah.
You what?
And you could, in your current play, you could play that.
I would hate to see it. I would hate to see that.
Put on a sailor hat. Put on a sailor wig.
Pleasure enough to see her play.
Have you ever thought what would have happened if you had stayed in Hollywood and written screenplays at the time that you were writing screenplays and all that? If things had worked out then,
They couldn't possibly. The situation was totally antipathetic. They couldn't sustain. As it was, I was only working out there for 2 or 3 weeks, but they had to continue to pay me even after they had dismissed me. They paid me for 6 months, and I was able to keep, you know, to draw pay for 6 months period. I felt a little dishonest about it, but I was assured that it was,
Did someone actually turn down The Glass Menagerie as a screenplay in this early
film? Nobody.
Anybody see it?
Nobody, but Eddie Downing could be. Nobody but Eddie Downing could be. His co-producer, Lloyd J. Singer, remained out of rehearsal, which was very late. And then we came in and he saw one rehearsal and he screamed, "Oh, Eddie, how could you do this to me?" But it was not submitted to Lewis and he had, I don't think he could read.
MGM didn't see it though.
Huh?
MGM didn't see it as a gentleman. They probably would have turned it down, I suppose.
I dare say they would, but they would be made out of the film. Unless they saw it as a vehicle for Mickey Rooney.
Jimmy Garland.
Poor Judy was living there. I know. How strange of you to ask that, because I started the play about Huey Long. I did a lot of research for it. I still have the books. Still have the books in my Key West studio, the books about Huey Long. And I wrote several very, very dramatic and interesting scenes for it. It was called Brush Hangs Burning. It was a sympathetic portrait of
him. I can't think of the guy.
And I've lost it. Several of my works have been lost. Because I don't have them. I don't make copies until they're finished. And sometimes they surface in trunks and warehouses, things that I didn't think were around, that had forgotten existed.
Can you take a different look at him? Time goes on.
Well, I haven't thought about him recently.
But something must have prompted you.
Yes.
What was it?
I don't remember really.
I thought
of him as a populist, you know, a man who really loved the people. Who was a vulgarian, but a man who loved the people and was fighting for them. And he was a victim of the establishment. That was my concept. I may have been altogether wrong. You see, I didn't complete my research.
Do you often do research for me?
Well, this is the time I attempted to write about a real figure. What made you think of him?
Well,
about, you know, you're kind of a political guy.
I'm not kind of political guy.
But I mean, you write about it. He's your linesman down there. And
that's the answer, probably.
I suspect that you must remember something about him.
I never met him, John.
No, I met him in that, but, you know, growing up down there.
And when you say he's my linesman, what do you mean by that?
Yeah, I was 7 years.
I think Huey was a redneck. I come of a rather distinguished southern lineage, sir.
Yes, sir. But he seems to be gaining a little better image as time goes on.
Yes, I think so. I don't insist that political leader be a gentleman. No. Well, I do insist he be a gentleman. Yes, a gentleman. Sense of the way. And I think there hasn't been any servicing lately since I did Stevenson, do you?
You would think
besides my brother, and he hasn't gotten
he
very far yet.
Do you think yourself as a Southerner?
Southern, born,
time
and bred.
Considering all the time you spent in the North up here.
Professionally, you mean?
Professionally, and also, you know.
I only stay only in New York when I happen to be in New York. I used to keep an apartment here, yes. I used to spend several months out of the year. Yeah. But
Key West is your home?
I have two homes right now, one in New Orleans and one in Key West. I have a little house in the French Quarter, a simple little house. And I have a simple little house in Key West. Both notable mainly for the outdoor areas.
No simple house in New York?
No, just as rich as it is.
Simple little hotel?
Yeah, and it's cheerful. Little apartment.
One thing from the play I was wondering, there's an exchange of dialogue about what's most meaningful about that. And it was whether something was interesting or not. There were several things.
What on earth is all this cooking table?
But
what were you saying?
Finally, one of the characters says that what really matters is still being surprised. The surprise.
Yes, yeah. And you must live in life as surprise, God is surprised.
Do you feel that the surprise has gone out of your life?
I lost it every time I wrote this play. I have recaptured it.
With this play, you've recaptured it?
I have recaptured it in my life. I am interested again, and I am capable of surprise, and I am capable of involvement with life again. During the late 60s, I was totally, I had lost it. And that was the period in which I wrote this play. This play is part of the catharsis of the period which came close to total disaster. And this play, an outcry, are both a catharsis of that period. And I think they're legitimate as catharsis of that period. I think an artist should put experiences into his work which are an essential part of his experience, because otherwise how can his work be truly organic? Otherwise it becomes manufactured, plastic, however skillfully done.
Yeah. Those plays lost, written after you've lost the surprise, or during the losing of it, or before?
During the losing.
During the losing.
Just trying to avoid the unbearably painful state of consciousness, except for those hours in which I went.
Which must have worked many hours if you produce so many works in a short space of time.
I shot myself with something that was lengthening. I don't know what it was. I won't go into it. It wasn't heroin. It was the opposite.
Right?
Yeah, it got me to the right there on time.
What was it?
What?
What was it? not the alcohol.
Now, for many years, I've had a drink beside me while I work, but I never remember the things. I mean, I just like it bad. I used to think about the dirt.
What sort of work habits, as I said, did you have in that period when you were writing it? So would you write all night long?
It was the only thing in my life that seemed that I could put it on to it. And I don't want to go back over all that. It's been so written now, and overexposed, don't you think? On talk shows, interviews. It seems to me like it's been overexposed.
But now you're presenting, you know, two plays which come from that period.
Yes, that's true. Yeah.
Isn't that also an exposure then?
Yes, but that's a place to expose it in the way.
Do you feel the need to write about something that came after that, or is this a compulsion?
I trust that I will have a life following these. And they will provide me with new experience. But I'm sure they will be happier experience. Although I doubt that I will lose what do they call it? The tragic sense of life. But at least with humor, because I think it can be.
Do you think perhaps that further plays might be happier or something? Everything.
Well, now, of course, I have plays and dramas. I always do. And I'm not going to. It's too late in the interview for me to, you know, launch off on attack about that. I don't like to anticipate what I'm doing in print, you know? I'm committed to complete an autobiographical work, yes. The first part of which will appear a summer edition of Esquire.
I read it's a comic, Doubleday, you offered you $50,000 for that, which seemed to me...
That's true.
Outrageous, that would offer only $50,000.
Well, I don't think Lloyd's of London would advise him to offer me more.
Do they think it's not forthcoming? Is it some dubious?
They want 100,000 words, man. I hope they'll settle for the excitement without the delay.
just in size, just in volume.
Well, I'm not going to do that kind of a thing, but no. No. I don't like working in very long prose forms. Novella is the longest I've ever done. Long prose. I can promise an interesting book, but, you know, a lot of length.
It seemed very low compared to some figures. Some figures they were tossing around for Rose Kennedy's autobiography, they were paying $500,000 or something. She's not going to write that.
I haven't had two sons killed yet.
But she hasn't written a good play lately, has she?
She doesn't have any
Irvings
yet.
What?
You don't have any Irvings
yet. No!
Or doing draw.
time is that right line read rehearsal? At 3 o'clock. Yeah.
What do you like to talk about interviews on this interview? And you don't like to talk about something.
What a crap.
We talk about it. I've talked about practically everything I like to
do. How does it feel to be in the off-Broadway world, 4th Street, South Bowery?
I love it.
Phoebe's district.
I love it, yeah.
Do you go to Phoebe's?
Yes, I love it there.
Nice and
sorry. I had a very funny little party there last night. There was a theater club party, ladies. And they had several bowls of pretzels, you know, on the table. And these good club party ladies were all sitting there. And they took a dim view of me in sight. And I'm very quick at getting these vibes. Also, a cat, two cats had gotten into the pretzels, which doesn't add much glamour to the kitty.
Those cats are always about there, they really are.
The cats were busy chewing away at the pretzels. And the dinner club body ladies were looking like the plumbing didn't work in Miami Beach Hotel. And I suddenly said, I went like that. And I said, I think playwrights should look at theater club party ladies and decide whether they want them in or out. So with that, I left.
It's probably the first theater party they've had at the truck and warehouse. I like that theater though.
I doubt they got any theater club party either, did they? After that.
But isn't there a room? They're part of town, right?
I shouldn't think so. I shouldn't be afraid.
You like it down there, though? I mean, as a
I like it down
situation.
There. Yes. I've had one or two unpleasant incidents, but now I was walking the first time we went to a rehearsal. I was at lunch break. I was walking up 2nd Avenue. And I passed this real freak-out man that had a poor dog, white dog, on a chain. And I saw the dog was crying, and I saw the dog's muzzle was a solid mass of scars. It looked like burns, like the man had extinguished cigarettes on the nose of the animal. And the dog was uttering these piteous cries. This wow-looking freak out snatched the chain off his neck, began to lash it with the chain. I said, I don't treat that animal like that. This man turned to me like he would kill me. And he said, mind your business, this is my dog, my goodness. And I think Mario, somebody was with me. Mario, weren't you with me? The major's quite ill.
I must tell you that we came to the theater last night.
Did he?
I could have let him come in, but he was not going to come in.
Now I've followed Mario's advice. I try, when I see these big guns coming toward me, we exchange smiles, mutual recognition, of course, and that's that. Well, this man, we should find that. Yeah. One must do that. One must do that. There was no way to get this man's name.
Did something else happen down there, too, you said?
Well, nothing except the sad business of stepping over the bodies of the drunks and the side. You know. Get it. Don't mention that. not that it's going to take business.
Have you seen any plays down there? Have you been to Cafe La Mama?
I tried to get in there last night and was thrown out.
Why were you thrown?
Well, they were rehearsing the truth of no.
They're doing Persia cheapy right now.
What? They're doing what?
Persia, a desert cheapy. They're doing right now.
Persia, desert cheapy. Now watch this stop. What time is it?
It's about 225.
Why is this stop?
It's a ridiculous theater.
They're doing what did you say?
Persia, a desert cheapy, which is one of the Theater of the Ridiculous productions. Yeah. Which the audience is supposed to imagine that it's on set or on location during the filming of an Arabian Nights movie.
Mm-hmm.
And they get pushed by all the actors. Does that sound at all relevant to your theater at all?
No, no. We don't have the actors come out from the audience. That's what business we have.
Your actors don't
what?
Touch the audience in that sense at all?
No.
No involvement up to that physical level.
I started that to come in a real, you know. But that's the only time I've ever used that. They tried to avoid touching the audience then. But they were criticized for coming out to the outside.
How do you feel as a member of the audience being touched by actors? Would that bother you being involved in it?
Not especially touching a flower.
Occasionally they do.
Do they do that?
Well, one play I saw this year, in fact, in which they grabbed me around the neck in a hammerlock.
Is this what they call the liquid theater?
That they kiss you. That was very sweet.
Kiss you. I want to see them first.
When your eyes are closed, you don't see them.
Well, I was killed for that.
But in the play by Arabelle, and the play by Arabelle and anybody handcuffs and the flowers, they grab each member of the audience at hammerlock in the pitch dark before the play begins.
Isn't it?
Somewhat off putting.
You have to go to theater for that. You go on the street and get
mugged. Arabelle, I was ejected from that too. I arrived late and I had the tickets. So the boom squad in the lobby and hopefully it takes me and got some readers about me. I was glad to get out and tell you the truth, but then reader made quite a scene.
Well, recently was it?
Oh, Arabelle's play, when was it? Later he wrote the story. Later he wrote the apologize for this. Ask me to see subsequently, but that was
like
a good play. I don't know if word. You see, I didn't see it.
That is a good play. And I haven't liked him before either. Who's their place to you by? Did you see, you see all over the other year?
Yes, I loved it. I hear it's been a very successful evening. I loved it.
Did you see all the time?
Close touch with the others, I should, because I'm not around the yacht as much. I am kept too busy.
Did you see these plays by David Ray, the basic training of
Who isn't he the guy who was the head of APF, or what do they call it? Isn't he a director?
No, he's a...
He was married to one of their leading ladies, wasn't he? David Drake?
Yes, she had two plays on one, Sticks and Bones, and the basic turned out
obviously one flew the cuckoo's nest. That's still running?
That's still running.
It's a psychiatric word, isn't it?
Did you like Sticks and Bones? Did you like Sticks and Bones?
Yes.
I think we should see that.
Should, yeah.
Yeah, should. Okay. What's it about now?
It's on Broadway.
It's about a boy coming home from Vietnam.
Oh.
He's blinded and unheard by his parents. But it's a very good young writer. I like the other play better, actually, which is just closed. It's touring now.
What's the name of that?
The Basic Training of Pablo Hummel.
Oh, what?
About
I've
a boy
seen
in
advertisement of that in TV, yeah.
Mm. But he's one of the few young.
Mm-hmm. House of Blue Leaves, I hear that was very well received on the West Coast. It was received well here, too.
Played at your fucking warehouse.
Yeah, I know it did, yeah. Mm. I haven't seen that. I haven't even seen Marigolds. I want to see Marigolds. Now I've got to stop to the theater. I'm making time for the line.
Would you mind if I went downtown? I'm going downtown anyway.
No, come ahead.
Mr. Williams, can I get the